think everyone is an expert in web design, just like everyone is an expert football coach, right? You know, you watch a Browns game on Sunday, and everyone has an opinion of what they ought to do, you know. Oh, they need to bring this guy in a quarterback, or they need to run more, they need to pass more, or whatever. So, in the same way, I hear people that haven't necessarily studied the field say, well, that website's bad because it's not intuitive or it's not user-friendly. And they may be right. You know, everyone has opinions on websites and what makes websites effective. What we want to do in this class, though, is go a little bit beyond the opinions, all right? and think about what really makes for a well-designed website, all right? There's another group of people that think that websites, you know, merely the attractiveness of websites is what makes them well-designed. If it looks good, then it is good, all right? I've had people, you know, we want it to draw people's attention in, and we want it to be colorful, and we want this and that. And any of those ideas might be worthwhile, but that is not the end-all, be-all of web design. So what we want to do is we want to take a more studied look, take a more systematic look about what makes a website well-designed versus poorly designed. We've already learned enough CSS to make your pages look pretty good. I think if you compare the last example that we did last Thursday with the first examples of the web page, you'll see that it looked a lot better. You know, there's things we could do even more to make it look even better still, but as it stands, we've made it look pretty good. We also could, if we wanted to, make it look really bad, right? We talked about putting a different color for literally every single tag and doing this and doing that, and we could really make it a mess. So what we want to learn is we want to learn not just technically how to do certain things, but we want to systematically look at what makes for a well-designed web page, more so than a web page, and beyond a web page, an entire website. So we'll discuss this for as long as the discussion makes sense to have, if that makes any sense. And then we'll sort of dovetail on to talking a little bit about your project, and I probably also want to talk about your portfolio in there as well. All right. Now, I asked you, and the next assignment involves you coming up with a page that has examples of good and well-designed websites and poorly designed websites. What I'd like to do is get some examples. Now, when you give me the example, don't tell me if it's a well-designed or poorly designed site. All right? We'll see if you folks can get that just by looking at it. Does anyone have an example? Scratching and another person just stretching. Darn. I've heard the difference, by the way. Are any of you in education or planning on teaching? I heard the difference between an experienced teacher and an inexperienced teacher is that an inexperienced teacher will ask a question, and if students don't immediately answer, they'll give the answer, or they'll give an answer. All right? Whereas an experienced teacher will sit there all day until a student answers. So I've been full-time teaching here since 2002. So that's 15 years. So I'm getting up there. So I don't know if I'll sit here all day. Like, I'm not a Don Huffman. I haven't been here for 30 years, but I've been here for 15 years. All right. So maybe I'll sit here for the rest of the hour. All right. Good, well-designed website, poorly designed website. You gotta be careful not to move too much.
How about the sports site at Yahoo?
Okay, and what is the URL?
Sports.yahoo.com.
All right, now don't say if you think it's well designed or poorly designed.
You'll see.
And again, well, hopefully we'll see. And again, this isn't, you know, don't think that this, you know, that I'm asking you to give some expert opinion. Just think about the sites that you like and the sites that you don't like. All right? That's enough for this discussion. And then we'll talk a little bit more about what you like and what you don't like. Sports.yahoo.com. Another thing to remember, by the way, is, you know, just like, you know, you talk about poorly designed and well designed. There might be parts of this we like and parts that we don't like, too. So keep that in mind. What was your initial reaction on seeing this?
Sluggard.
Busy. I don't like it.
Okay, wow, boy. See, we got some opinions already. Cluttered, busy, I don't like it. All right. Specifically, what are some things that you think would make this better?
The giant advertisement.
The not giant advertisement is really kind of annoying. All right. Of course, they have to make their money, right? So they do give you the option to close it eventually, which is good. And they also give you the option to say, "I don't like this ad." Here I'm torn, because I wouldn't like any ad in this place, but if you are going to put an ad up there, a pizza ad is as good as any, right? If you have to put an ad, you know. So I'm hesitant to click "I don't like that ad," because I'm liable to get an ad I like even less next time. So I'm just going to say collapse. I'm not going to vote on that. Okay, so I would agree. The ad is bad because it took up a lot of space, and it took up a lot of prominent prime time space. Of course, the reason for that is so that you can see it, and of course the reason for that is they sold that space and all that. That's maybe a different discussion, but I would agree that sort of makes the page look weak. Now that we've gotten rid of the ad, what do you or do you not like about it? Is it still cluttered?
Yeah.
Okay. What are some suggestions that you might think to do? Instead of having the actual headlines, have a link to headlines.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or put a collapse button there too and get rid of it.
Or put a collapse button there too. Yeah. Show headlines, high headlines. That's true. Keep in mind, the suggestions you make, we don't necessarily have to know how to do in this class. All right. But we can just talk about it. But the big observation is clutter. The symptoms the cure is to put less stuff on the page, right? So we got rid of the ad. We talked about maybe make this collapse.
I think it has decent navigation, though.
You know, decent navigation?
If you want to narrow it down, you can just pick and then...
Okay. So the navigation looks reasonably good. All right, sports homes, fantasy. It's weird to me that fantasy football and baseball would like be the first item on the list, right? But I don't know. Maybe they know their customers. But this navigation is good. Another thing about this, and in a way this is part of the issue that I have with Yahoo completely, is that you also get another navigation up here for the other areas of Yahoo. All right? So you sort of have the main whole Yahoo navigation here, and then you have the sports navigation there. That being said, they do it in a fairly clear way, as was mentioned. Up here is for all the main points in Yahoo. And I would guess that if we went to finance, for example, that top stays exactly the same. So no matter where you are, if you're using Yahoo as sort of your portal, to use a term that they used several years back, into the web, all your main links are up here, right? And you can go to them, you can go to news, you can go to sports, and so on. they're doing an okay job with their ads, at least. All right. I mean, I don't like it that big, but hey, pizza then Metallica. So. Oh, I clicked. I don't like. Shoot.
I like that. That's the first option.
Yeah. I'll just click done. Now I got a big white space in there. Oh boy. Huh. It's weird that they gave me a smaller ad. This ad, anyhow. This isn't a class about advertisements. One thing that used to be a big deal in the old days is that you told people, you told web designers not to make the site so that you could have to scroll it to get to it. That was always a big consideration. That's really not as much of a consideration now. People understand how to scroll, and in fact, on tablets and a phone, scrolling's a piece of cake, right? You're just, boom, with your finger to swipe, all right? So this is a long page, but somehow the long page doesn't bother me so much. Any other observations on this page?
It's nice that you can like personalize it. Like up there you got, you know, like the browns.
Okay. It's good that you can personalize it. It looks like what it did is based on our location. It picked the closest NFL team, the closest hockey team. That looks like a Red Wing. And the closest baseball team. All right, so customizable, that's good. There probably are more settings if I was actually logged in that I could do. All right. So if you're going to criticize this and talk about the pros and cons of it, if I can summarize and anyone could add on to it. First thing is that it's very cluttered. There's a lot of stuff going on in there. The good part is it seems to have a decent navigation to take you through where you need to go, both within the sports section and the Yahoo site overall. Does anyone else have an example of either a good site or a bad site? Yes?
Zenhabits.net.
Zenhabits.net.
Yeah.
Is it all one word?
Yep.
Okay. I'm always really frightened about just typing in URLs.
It's a lot different than the site because I absolutely no clutter in it.
Okay.
It's basically a blog.
Okay. Someone's blog about if you notice, it might be hard to see. Actually, you can see this. It looks as about veganism. Understanding why. All right. What do we like or not like about this?
It's really organized, but unless you really wanted some information on it, I don't think most people would want to even take the time to scroll through it because it's just, there's nothing to catch your eye or...
I think the articles are at the bottom, actually, but that's not really a good place to put them.
Let's see.
So yeah, there is a lack of navigation on that.
See all posts. There we go. Keep in mind that as a blog, if you were following this blog, it would be something that you'd read like a newspaper, like something that you'd read and visit it every day or every couple days or whatever. And the most recent articles are at the top. So you wouldn't necessarily scroll through. This being our first time visiting it, we want to see everything that's on there. So there is a navigation. But again, the navigation isn't necessarily a good place. Other comments about this? How is this as far as clutter goes?
Centered in the middle of the page, so gives off an organized feel for it.
Yeah. It isn't cluttered at all, I would say. It's laid out good. How does the look match the content? How would you describe the look of this page if you had to pick like a word or an emotion?
Clean.
Clean, basic. Plain.
Minimalist.
Calm, even. You know, if you were going to say, you know, busy versus calm, this is calm. What would Yahoo be busy? And again, it's funny because listening to the words that you described, there's even sort of the word that you used. Even in a way indicates partly, unless I'm reading too much into it, your opinion on this, right? Think of clean versus plain, right? Which one sounds not? Which one sounds like a more positive response?
Clean,
right? Which one sounds like maybe a neutral or slightly negative response? Plain, all right? And again, that is a risk. That you might do something that appeals to one group of people but not another group of people. Hopefully you know your audience and you're able to make some. And again, with the word Zen in the title, talking about veganism, and I think there's other sort of similar related topics. Let go of distractions. It would kind of be bad if you had a page to talk about letting go of distractions and there were animated ads and that kind of stuff going on, right? So in one respect, the design of this supports the content, all right? It has a clean, calm design because hopefully the material, the content on the site is meant to be calming and peaceful and that sort of thing. Now again, the flip side of that is to some that could translate to boring. All right, but given the audience that it's going for, I would say that's a valid consideration. Other comments about this? There's a word that people use, and in fact, I've used it before in a different sense, but I've talked about within your HTML code having white space, how you can put things. That's a different kind of white space. This makes use of a lot of white space. What do I mean by white space? Again, regardless of the actual color of the background, the white space is the space between things. So the space from side to side, the space between the bullet point items, the space between the paragraphs, and so on. All right? That is the white space. And again, a site that uses a lot of white space does tend to give that clean, uncluttered look. A site that doesn't use a lot of white space, again, has a potential of giving a cluttered look. Now let's compare the extra space here versus this. It's only given me small ads since I said I didn't like that one ad. That's interesting. All right. If we had to, and again, this is very difficult, but if we had to say a percentage of blank space on this page, I'm not going to give a number because that would be ridiculous. You know, it's the old thing about, you know, 80% of statistics are made up, right? You know, that was meant to be a joke. I'm not going to come up with a number, but as you see, Stuffer is very closely put together on here, where stuff is more spacious here. Now, if you think about this, It makes perfect sense, right? Yahoo Sports is trying to be very comprehensive and cover a whole bunch of stuff for a whole bunch of people. And what more? They're trying to make some money at it. All right. So that space equals money. All right. Whereas this seems to be just a personal blog that someone does for their own benefit and maybe to get some information out that they think is useful to people, and people are reading it in a different way. Therefore, there's less reason to jam everything in, and there's a lot more white space. All right. Other examples of good or bad websites.
Apple.com.
Opinions on this.
They feature their product prominently so people can buy it.
All right. They feature their products prominently. So you're going to this page. Gee, what are the new products that Apple's coming out with? Well, it looks like an iPhone 7. Looks like Series 2 Watch. And it looks like maybe a new generation of MacBook Pros. Boom. You can sort of have that answer your question within 15 seconds of accessing that page. And notice you have it without any words, all right? There's no words. Well, I take that back. There are words, but there aren't a lot of words, all right? It isn't like a big article that you're reading about their product releases. Let's look at their navigation. Let's go to Mac, for example. All right? Under Mac, they have the basic thing they had before, and they also have different variations, the MacBook Air. MacBook Pro. And so on. All right, go to iPad. You have a similar sort of navigation. This navigation, again, stays constant. Going back to the Zen page that we looked at, the one criticism I would have is that the main criticism I would have is to have some sort of navigation, maybe have this stuff at the top instead of at the bottom. Because I'm liable to miss that was there even. Without that. Apple navigation, though, is hard to miss. Does every page look the same on this site? Kinda is the perfect answer, right? Yes and no, right? I guess it depends what you mean by does it look the same. This page looks different than this page in the fact that this page has a white background and darker text. This page has a dark background and white text. But they look the same in that the main navigation is constant. The sub-navigation looks the same. All right. There's a big picture, and then there's some additional stuff down here, and you can go and see particular models of it as you navigate through. Your goal in designing a website isn't necessarily making all your pages look the same. It's making them look consistent. So there can be some variance in it. All right? There can be a little bit of variance between one page and another page. All right? Other comments on this page. Do we like it? Color scheme is very appealing. I might even say, what color scheme? All right? go ahead.
It's the monochrome color scheme.
Right, exactly. The fact that there's not a lot of colors at work here. There looks like there's white a dark shade of gray, and splashes of blue here and there. Plus, of course, there's some color in the pictures. But like, boom. Now, when you see a page like this, and every single piece of text is one color, except these are a slightly different shade, they're a shade of blue, that stands out, right? That stands out simply because it's different than everything else. Well, it is different than everything else. It's the learn more and buy link. It's two links that they want you to see. So therefore, it stands out, all right? And notice how they do that, not by using millions of different colors, but just using a splash of colors. And the color scheme goes very, very, very consistent and very, very subdued. Does anyone have an Apple product, like an iPhone? Yeah. All right. What does your font look like? Does your font look a lot like this on the back of the phone or wherever the words are written? Yeah, it probably does, right? Another thing that Apple does very effectively on the site is, and I hate this word, but marketers use it all the time, is branding. All right? In other words, my guess is we could go and scramble the letters on this site, you know, encrypt it, use different letters. You would look at that and probably know it was Apple's site. All right? Simply by the use of type, the use of a very clean, uncluttered, lot of white space web page. All right. What kind of image does Apple try to portray for their products? What is their selling point?
You should buy the latest product.
Well, you should buy the latest product. Even though you don't need it. All right.
User friendly.
Simple. Right. Well designed. Care taken in the design of it. That's an important consideration. One of the taglines of their commercials years ago, and may even still be, was something like, it just works, right? And again, the simplicity and attention to detail and that sort of thing shows in their website. So their website sort of makes a connection with their products. Their website has the same feel that they're trying to portray in their products. Now, this isn't a point to argue what is better, a Mac and a PC. You know, I mean, I'm not even saying that. What I'm talking about is from the perspective of the image that they want to portray, the design of the site goes very, very closely in line with the image that they're trying to portray of the product. All right? Questions? Another well or poorly designed site.
Craigslist.
We'll just make sure we're very careful in clicking that one. You know, when you get to a certain age and you don't really do exciting things, one time I went over to my friend's house and he was just reading random ads on Craigslist to me just for our amusement. I don't know, while we were watching a basketball game or something. And that's about as much fun as I can take, I think. All right, Cleveland's Craigslist. Well, here we go. Let's look for sale. Look for musical instruments for sale. That should be safe, right? $1 for a banjo? I'm going to just buy it just to have a banjo laying around my house. Shopping here. All right. Over here there are FAQs. Opinions on this?
It looks like
garage sale section of the Journal or something.
It looks like the garage section of the Lorraine Journal or some sort of newspaper. Well, yeah, it does. Is that a bad thing?
That's kind of what they're doing, right?
Yeah, I say that's kind of what they're doing, so I honestly don't know if that's a positive or negative thing. I guess it just is what it is. Other comments about this?
It doesn't really seem to be a theme on it.
A theme in what sense?
Just colors and overall feel of it.
Yeah, colors and overall feel of it. Seems very plain, very generic. No images that I can see.
It's to the point.
All right. Again, it's to the point, right? There are images when you look at individual products, but what kind of image would really add to the value here, all right, on this page, all right? All the text is blue, or nearly all the text is blue. Why do you think that is?
Because they're links.
They're all links. Well, even this, which isn't blue. How is it organized? What do you think of the organization of the links on this site?
You gotta look blue.
You do. We're gonna do something here. We're going to do what's called a user test case. We're going to have in mind something, and we're going to see how quick it takes for us to find it. It's called a usability test or a use case or something like that. If we're going to finish this use case, we'd actually go and contact a person and tell them we were interested and see how that goes. Now, I know that Craigslist website isn't responsible for the interaction between you and the seller, but getting you connected with the seller, it is responsible. What do we want to buy today?
A car.
We want to buy a car. What kind of car?
Camaro.
A Camaro. All right. What other restrictions do we have? Are we looking for a newer one, an older one?
Used one.
Like old, real old, or? Okay. 80s, we're looking for an 80s, 90s Camaro. Let's see how long it takes to find it. All right. First thing we're going to have to do is find the category. Community, housing, discussion forum, for sale. All right, for sale, that's what we're interested in. Cars and trucks. All cars and trucks. Let's do that. And we have a list of a whole bunch of things here, all right? But we can narrow it down by saying Camaro. Oh, Chevy Camaro. Top one on the list. A lot of people must be doing this example today. And there we go. Pick this one. It's an 80s one. And we can email it to the friend, or I've never used Craigslist, so I'm not sure what you do next. Is there a way to contact the person?
It says on the bottom, it says,
email to a friend, best of, do not contact me.
Probably it's in person.
Pardon me?
Maybe it's an in-person meeting.
Don't try.
It sounds good. It's a nice day out. Let's do it. but how do we arrange? Do we just drive around Sandusky looking for this car, or? I guess that's what I am not sure what to do next. Reply. Go. All right. So reply. So that is pretty obvious. Oh, and they give you someplace to email and all that. If you're going to rate your experience finding this Camaro, was it easy or hard? Pardon me?
Pretty easy.
Pretty easy, right? Pretty easy. You know, and this is interesting because, you know, sometimes I'm surprised. When someone said Craigslist, I fully expected to go to that page and just spend the next hour criticizing it and say how horrible it was. All right? And yet, when I actually thought about it, it ain't bad. All right? This page is very plain, but at least there's some level of organization to it. Think about what their job is. Their job is to sell, like, anything, all right? To sell all kinds of stuff, like you said, like the world's garage sale or Cleveland's garage sale. So there's going to be a lot of stuff they have to sell, you know? Just like Yahoo has a lot of sports that they have to cover. So if you have a lot of material, a lot of content for it, you're stuck with that restriction. You have to be able to handle it. And how do you handle it? You handle it by organizing the content in a good, logical way. Now, it took a second for us to go and look for and find cars. I was a little surprised it had auto here and there weren't automobiles, but they have cars and trucks. Okay, that took a short second. It took me a second to realize I could search by car and all that. But really, it wasn't that bad of an experience. I guess my point is that looks can be deceiving. Visually, this is not anything where people would say is a great looking site, and so on. And to be sure, maybe we could make improvements to make it even better, all right? But in terms of what I wanted to do, all right, buy a Camaro, 1980s used Camaro, we were able to accomplish that pretty quickly and painlessly. All right? Anyone else have another example? Good or bad? I'm going to pick one of my favorite. I spoiled it.
I don't like it.
Yeah, you don't like it, right? Google. All right. Now, I already tipped my cards and said I like this. Why do you think I like it?
It's just a search bar.
Just a search bar. All right? Just a search bar. Notice when I go to Google, what am I doing? I'm likely going to be searching for something, all right? Let's say I'm searching for some information on HTML. I type in H, it shows me everything that, it does show me everything. It shows the four most popular things that start with H. I type in HT, shows me the three most popular things that start with HT. Ah, there I go, I can pick it. And away we go. Again, another example of a site that isn't visually dazzling, but simply works well. You know, Google's claim to fame is that their search engine gave better results than anyone else, right? That's how they rose to their level of prominence. They did a better job searching the web, all right? Again, things are probably closer now than they were in the past, but back, you know, when Google first became popular, that was their claim to fame. You know, because searching, you want to find the things that are relevant and exclude the things that aren't relevant, but look like they might be relevant. And Google takes into account a lot of factors. They take into account where you're located at, right? So if I search for Italian restaurants, notice what I get. I get a list of Italian restaurants around where I am located. In Elyria, Ohio, North Ridgeville. 10 best Italian restaurants in Cleveland. 10 best Elyria restaurants, Elyria Midway Mall, and so on. Do you suppose that means that the best Italian restaurants in the world are in Elyria? Probably not. All right. It's smart enough, though, to give me good results. And it gives good results based on location. It's smart enough to know if I'm looking for a restaurant, chances are I'm looking for a restaurant near where I live. All right. Because I'm probably want to know where I'm going to eat tonight. All right. So it gave me, it helped serve my goal. Right? When I'm going to Googling something, I'm looking for information that I can use. And it's smart enough to know that if you're looking for a restaurant, you're probably thinking of where you're going to go, either tonight or sometime in the future. And therefore, it makes sense to customize your place, your search based on where you live. All right? Now, another thing. There's a whole bunch of factors that come into play. In fact, Google doesn't, that's a secret. That's a trade secret, exactly how Google searches, because that's where they gain their competitive advantage. Google also considers what you've searched for before in coming up with new results. I'll give you, for instance, there is a hockey commentator named Don Cherry. All right? There's a jazz musician called Don Cherry. All right? Two people that are completely related. Are completely unrelated, that simply share the same name. Google is smart enough to know that if you've done a lot of searches about hockey, if you search for Don Cherry, it's going to show you more prominently the information about the hockey guy. And if you are searching and you've done a lot of searches on jazz musicians, it's going to show you information about the jazz musician named Don Cherry. Now, we haven't done a lot of search on here, so I'll bet you our search results contain a mix. There's the hockey guy. Top two entries are the Wikipedia entries about Don Cherry, the hockey guy, Don Cherry, the musician. Hockey, hockey, musician, hockey, 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 and so on. And see, I picked this deliberately because I thought it would be a non-controversial topic, right? And that just goes to show you, if it's on the internet, it's subject to argument. All right. But the point is that people don't go to Google to admire their brilliant graphic design. People don't go to any page to admire its graphic design and to say, wow, that's really a beautiful web page. I'm going to sit back and just watch this web page for a while because it's that beautiful, I'm going to print it out and hang it on my refrigerator, that sort of thing. You go there with a specific purpose. And one of the fundamental beliefs that I have is that how well the website helps you achieve your purpose is really a sign of two things. It's a sign that has good content and it's a sign that has good design. If either of those two things fail, then your purpose isn't going to be solved. So Google has good content in its search results, does a good job finding stuff that you're interested in. If Google didn't do that, then it wouldn't be successful. And the design makes it very easy to find stuff. There's only one place on the page where you can enter text, all right? And your cursor is already in there when you go onto this page. You don't have to do anything except type and hit the search. Let's compare this with Yahoo. Yahoo also does a search engine, but Yahoo tries to pose itself as being more than a search engine. It's, again, the old term that people use. I don't know if they still use it today, but it's a portal. It's your way of entering the web. So if I go to Yahoo, notice I see about a million different things, and one of the million things I can do is do a search. All right? And one thing that's nice about Google, by the way, is even though it's very plain and all that, they from time to time put cute little icons up here, like for someone's birthday or today's Valentine's Day or, as the Christmas holidays approach. They do those sorts of things and all that. So it's not like they are completely stuffy and plain. They throw enough little visual interesting elements to make it interesting. Other examples of good or bad website? Yes.
NVIDIA.com.
How do you spell that?
N-V-I-D.
NVIDIA.
I-A. It's a graphics card manufacturer.
Oh, okay. N-V-I-D-A?
I-A.
Oh, okay. NVIDIA.com. All right. Global. We're in U.S. and Canada. What do we think of it?
Branded.
Branded, definitely. Black and green are the color schemes, definitely. It's a search. If we don't know, games we can look for. What do we think of this? Thumbs up or thumbs down? Who's voting thumbs up?
I like it.
Who's voting thumbs down? Yeah, I think it's reasonably good. It's a minor beef. But this script could, this page could be smart enough to know where I am and direct me, and then ask me to go somewhere else. Ask me if I want to go somewhere else. Because just because I'm located in the United States doesn't mean I may be interested. I may be, for example, in a business that deals with Mexico, and I want to see products that are available in Mexico or whatever. So it's not 100% that I would always only want to see the location that I am currently in, and but that's sort of the default, I would think. And then there, you could have the option to change it if you wanted to. All right, I'll tell you. You guys did a great job for discussion, but there's one tiny thing I'm disappointed in. All right, we haven't seen a really awful website in class. All right, so that's what I'll ask you to do for Thursday. Try to find the worst, most god-awful, ugliest, hideous, wretched website that you can possibly find. And let's talk about that, right? Because you can learn good design by studying bad design, right? Good design principles are simply the reverse of bad design principles, right? If we find a website where we can't read the text because there's not adequate contrast in the colors, then we can glean the web design principle of have good contrast between the colors and make your text readable, and so on. So let's find some really, really, really bad websites for Thursday, and let's continue this discussion. All right, we'll see you in lab.